All right.
I haven't checked my camera.
This is just a great photo.
Yep. Hi, everybody. This is John. I'm here with Timmy and George and Bill Cobe, George Pratt, Bill Cobe, Timmy, myself. And there's more coming in. So I know Dale's joining us and Audrey Benjaminson will be joining us. And Dale's never on time, so he always has to draw towards the end. So I got a few things I want to say tonight before we get started. This is kind of a little bit of a tearjerker for me. Seems like
we're all going to be crying.
Yeah. But before we get to that part, I'm just going to briefly mention. This is brought to you by Visual Arts Passage. We got our online classes. We're in the middle of a semester right now. We have one class that kicks off a week from Tuesday on August 25th. It's color theory with Brent Watkinson. Fabulous class. If you have any interest, please let us know. You cannot go wrong. This is an amazingly smart class. Brent introduces practical application with color. We'll introduce you to artists you've never heard of before, and you'll remember for the rest of your life. Really, really great information. Our life drawing. Just real quickly, I don't want to get into a long diatribe about this, explaining everything, but these are people that have joined us over the last. Did you say it was our 19th episode?
Yeah. 19th since I started counting.
Unbelievable. So real quickly, at the top, you got George Bratt, Audrey Benjaminson, Gil Ashby, myself, John Foster, Brent Watkinson, Hector Casanova, Bill Cove, Don Kilpatrick, Ashley Lovett, Vanessa Del Rey, Dale Stefanos, and then Ray Bonilla at the end. I left out one person, because I have kind of a special drawing I wanted to show, something he did last week when the Wade brothers came in. Chris Payne did this drawing while we were drawing, posted at one of the poses. He had taken a screen capture of the Wade brothers sitting there talking and did this drawing of them, which just blew me away. I just love this drawing. It's so unbelievably good. To do a double portrait and nail both of them in a few minutes is pretty extraordinary. So Chris, thank you. Chris is not here tonight because he's traveling. So I wanted to thank the Wades again for being so thoughtful and sharing the photography. And they're just terrific.
And the only thing, I'm really excited to let everybody know that they're hooking us up with some pretty awesome photographers. And so we are stocked to the gills with awesome photography for cool.
That's great. Well, tonight, that's a good segue, Timmy, because tonight we're doing some photography from Tim's father. Now, Tim's father was not, quote, a photographer. By profession, but he was a good photographer and he traveled the world. He did things. If you go to his Instagram account, it's just like, my God, he lived the life of 10 people and he did some extraordinary things. This is a picture of how I got involved with the Trebons. That's a picture of my father and Tim together. I told you I'd get emotional about this and I'm trying not to, but I love these two guys so much. They're just fantastic. And Tim, I met Tim long before Timmy was born. I met Tim when I was 17 years old, his father. And he just impressed me so much. He was just a bigger than life, an amazing character, a great storyteller, and really fun to be around. This is a family portrait of, without Tim, this is Patty, Tim's wife, and Tim's mother. And there's Tony, and Michael and Timmy. This is Timmy right there. I'm guessing this is Timmy right there. Of course, he's grown his muscles off already. He's only 4 or 5 years old at the time. Fabulous family. And Tim was a great father and family man first. He developed a business and had just, right after he passed away, they just celebrated the 50th anniversary of his company that he built from the ground up. Just an amazing success story. And the company, which I think he needed something that allowed him to fund the travels and the adventures that he went on. Tim was a very successful. He has another business or passion as a cattle rancher, and owned a large cattle ranch in northern Missouri. This is one of my favorite photos of Tim ever taken. I just absolutely love that shot of him. This is another photo of Tim as a cowboy.
Oh, wow. I remember that.
I'm just gonna. I gotta say, you led with the big, you know, 50th anniversary photo. You know, he for the longest time, it was him operating a print shop out of the basement of the house that I'm in.
You know, yeah,
so the same basement that we were taking photos of our model Chris in, he for years ran a little print shop out of there. Mostly for like business cards for plumbers, you know, like just what to get by. He printed his high school newspaper for tuition. So he was like, so it
grew a little bit.
A little bit, yeah.
A little bit. And he was a great businessman. This was the year, I loved this photo because it was the year I met him in 1977. And he was an adventurous soul. It takes a lot of nerve to get on a bull. And I
didn't he do that on a bet?
It wasn't a bet, it was for work.
Okay.
I'll leave names out. You guessed the art director in Kansas City named Gannat. he met what I think the right term, maybe a rambunctious creative director in Kansas City, who my dad had like no clients, and the guy challenged him to a bull riding competition. Said, if you can outride me, I'll send some work your way. And I think the result was there's two different versions of the story. There's Gannat's and my dad's. But yeah, they became good friends.
Yeah, well, a brave.
My dad has a good photo. I don't think Gannat has a good photo.
Yeah, so. I don't think Gannat stayed on long enough to have a good shot. So here's another passion of Tim's. And Tim, I don't know exactly how long, but Cousteau. He became the chief financial officer of the Cousteau Society and traveled the world with the Cousteau Society. I love this shot with him and Jacques Cousteau. And this was at the next shot is in 1982 at the very beginning of the travels through the Amazon that Cousteau filmed. And there was a 7,000 mile journey through the Amazon.
And I want to add some context. This all occurred. My dad's dream was to meet Jacques Cousteau. And he was stuck in a basement, printing business cards for local businesses. Felt like it was kind of a dead end situation. And he would write what essentially I would say are fan letters to the Cousteaus, you know, trying to convince them to let him work with them. He wanted to print for them. He was trying to just do anything he could to get his foot in the door. And I've heard a lot of different versions of how it happened, but he told me once, he goes, I just knew if I could meet someone who had an in, it would be my way of getting in. And he was like, and I knew John Denver spent a lot of time on the Calypso, which was the ship that the Cousteaus sail on. Now, if you're not familiar with the Cousteaus, because a lot of people here are younger and they probably have no idea, the Cousteau Society they were like the rock stars of like nature documentaries preceding any nature documentary ever happening. It's the reason why when you hear a French accent parodying a documentary film, it is the reason why you hear it is a French accent. And Jacques Cousteau is the pioneer in underwater exploration. And so this was an outrageous dream he had. And his thought process, this really puts my dad's mentality into mind. He was like, if I just knew somebody that had an in, I could get in. And he was like, and I knew John Denver was on the Calypso a lot, which would be like if you wanted to meet Mick Jagger, right?
Through David Bowie.
Yeah. Well, all I got to do is get tight with David Bowie and I'm in, right? Right? And so, John, I believe the relationship, there's so many different blended versions of it. And the fun version of it is, this became a big part of your dad and my dad's relationship.
Absolutely.
Your dad helping my dad figure out a way to get in with the Cousteaus, which I have. I'll pull up, about halfway through, I'll pull up. I found one of your dad's illustrations he did to help my dad with this. But long story short, John Denver went on tour and had a show in Kansas City. And both our dads found themselves hanging out with John Denver at a bar. And my dad, and helped my dad, you know, pitch this idea that he had, is why he wanted to work with the Cousteaus. And kind of, you know, at the time, he's still running a business out of a basement. Definitely, he had no, at the time, he had not, I don't know that he had been on the ocean, let alone had any reason to travel with the Cousteaus. So also, you know, it's a longer story, but it is really a, I saw Jean-Michel Cousteau, Jacques Cousteau's son, a couple years ago, and he said, your dad was like a fish out of water. And for whatever reason, everybody always wanted to get him wet. You know, so anyways, it's a really fun story. And these are photos where he was traveling. He's just going on these wild adventures. I don't know if they brought him along just because they thought it would be funny to have a guy from Kansas City with him. They brought him along because he's so likable. But
well, your father was an amazingly engaging individual. He was very bright and very, very personable, and also very, as you can see from the bull riding, very, very willing. So he was the perfect character for it. I know that the assistance my dad had was the fact that he had done several album covers for John Denver and had an in with John Denver. So that was the interest, and they literally sat at a bar and decided who would be the best individual and explore somebody famous to do a print of that would be not like of an actor or something that had integrity. And they ended up with Jacques Cousteau, and that became how they were going to pursue that. That's the story that I remember here. But anyway, this is day one of this 7,000 mile journey. This is day two. And I always love this photograph.
Yeah, wow, that's so great.
And this explains some of the misery that they went on, because as Tim said, is when he told me, he thought, oh, great, I'm going to be like on the water traveling down the Amazon. He said, basically, I got to walk through the jungle alongside of the boat. Yeah. They went on ground. He was, you know, he was a rookie on the travels, and he had to pay his dues.
That I've got another photo I'll show to you. That FJ made it to the Baja 1000.
Really?
Wild. Yeah. I think by the end of it, they told Toyota was the sponsor, and they told them they were going to they were going to return the Toyota after the expedition, and Toyota saw a photo and they were like, yeah, don't worry about it.
Yeah. He said basically the larger vehicle that they were, the amphibious vehicle, basically the last half of the trip, it drugged the Toyota back. He wasn't opposed to getting dirty. This was later in life at the ranch. And I think your mom shot this picture. I always liked this.
Yeah.
And then I put this in there because it's just Tim Trayvon at his best. You know,
that was a day. That was minutes before he met my brother's father and mother-in-law.
just doing a little yard work.
That was the introduction. Yeah.
So I wanted to thank Patty for allowing us to borrow Tim so much. And Patty has been very friendly and helpful with our pursuits, what we've been doing educationally, and a thank you to them both. So before we get into the photography of Tim's work, I just wanted to thank them and give you a little background of who Tim Trabon was. I could fill the whole night doing this.
Stories. Yeah, and a thing that I always like forget to mention is he was a partner in our business with the online school.
Absolutely.
And miss him a lot. He really helped us build this from the start. And so, he was really hands-on when we first started Visual Arts Passage and everything we've done with the Academy. And yeah, so.
So anyway, thank you, Tim and Patty. And I think we're ready to draw. So yeah, Bill, you're up first.
And I should add, tonight, a lot of the photography we're using, it's photography of tribes and these photos were taken in 1982. If you're in the Facebook group, you'll see a post that I made. And I think it's really important to, you know, I know we spent a lot of time talking about my dad. I wish I had educated myself more on the photography we're using tonight. I plan to do so in the coming weeks. But first of all, I think it's really important to remember that these tribes are currently undergoing a great deal of just injustice currently with the global situation. And I have shared a link to a Business Insider article that goes into this in detail, but it also links to a petition that I highly recommend checking out. You know, when they originally went in 1982, they were going there to document a lot of these unjust threats that were being imposed on these communities. And it's really unfortunate that these are still happening to an even greater unfathomable extent today. And so a lot of this is related to COVID. So please take time to educate yourself looking forward to drawing these tribes, and I'll be sharing more information this week about, you know, ways our group can help creatively, or sign things, or donate your time or your money.
All right, I'll stop sharing and we can go to Bill. This is interesting because we're supposed to have several other drawers join us from our end, and they're not here yet. So we may end up sharing a lot of our screens tonight. So let's get going.
So I have a question before I start. Either of you guys know what tribe this man is in, or where he's from, or?
Yeah, it is I believe the Kiapo tribe, and I would be. I had a.
How do you say it?
Oh man, Bill.
I think you're right to me.
I know it's the Kiapo tribe, but I need to look up more information because this individual is a very he's a known chief globally.
You gotcha.
So, but I don't want to provide any information that's like not accurate.
No, that's fine. I understand. I picked this one because one, I like 3/4 views of faces, you know, and I think the tones and the color in his skin and his face, and the reds and the headdress and the blacks, I just thought, and the shape of his hair, I just thought it was all really beautiful. So, I'm using a bunch of different things. I'm using pastels and Conti crayon and a few different things, and I'm trying to match the shape and the color. So I'm just gonna focus in on his head and see where this goes.
All right, I just started the clock.
And John, my computer showed me as muted. Did you hear me speaking about the
yes,
Amazon tribes?
Yes.
I spoke for like a minute and then like saw the muted thing. I was like, what?
I don't think it was. I think it happened.
Okay, good. Good. Will we get George to stream video tonight? Is the big.
I told him he didn't have to if he didn't want to.
Okay. All right.
So I'm just starting with the shape of his face, and I'm just kind of filling in a brown, kind of rusty brown color. I don't know if you can see that okay.
Looks great, though.
Thanks. And I'm going to hide my screen from me because I don't think I can watch myself draw while I draw. You know, and I'm looking at the shape of his brow and the really pronounced shape of his cheekbone. You know, one thing about drawing that I think about is that when you're drawing something, you're always drawing the far edge of what you're seeing. So, you know, I'm obviously drawing the things close to me too, but the outline is always the far edge of whatever you're seeing. So I was trying to explain to somebody the other day the difference between drawing from a photograph where you've never drawn from life at all and drawing, you know, where you have. And I think there's the difference is that you sort of get used to seeing around the form. And I sort of measure, you know, I'll just kind of eyeball, you know, the distance from his hair to his brow and the distance from his brow to his chin. And then I'll adjust as I need to. I don't mind redrawing things. And I also don't mind if things are not quite 100% on. I used to get really caught up with that, like things had to be exact. But sometimes drawing happens differently than that. But everything becomes a way to see the relationships between the spaces. So like the hair to the lips, the shape. You know, this shape right in here and the way it relates. To the cheeks.
So I was panicking. I'm the worst at like flashcards, Bill. And when you ask about the tribe, I try to remember. I'm horrible at names. Like,
oh, that's all right.
No, and I'd written these things down because I've been transferring all the slides.
Yeah.
I've got this crate of slides, just like thousands of them that I'm trying to transfer 50 at a time. But it is Chief Rayoni of the Kiapo tribe.
Thank you. Chief Rayoni of the Kiapo tribe. Well, I hope they do him justice.
Of the Kiapo people.
The Kiapo people, thank you.
Yeah, sorry. I was incorrect. Yeah.
It kind of seems like a really odd word to me. People sounds more.
Well, what's what is really wild is following my dad meeting this chief, he became internationally an internationally known chief. And if you look him up online, there are photos of him with Sting and all of these global leaders. It's really amazing. Because I have a photo, there's a photo of me, or there's a photo of my dad with him back 1982. It's just it's hard to believe, but here, I'll share the spelling for everybody because he's a really interesting character, individual. I am really excited because I grew up, my dad went on several expeditions with the Cousteaus, but I never ever saw a documentary, any of the documentaries. He would always talk about them, but they were all from the 1980s, predating the home VHS. So no one ever really had a copy. And I was looking through these photos and I was looking to see if I could find any video footage to share. And literally 7 days ago, some guy found one at a Hollywood Video that still exists.
Oh, wow.
Right? I don't even know where, not a Hollywood Video, but a video rental store of some sort, or record store, I don't know. But he digitized it and posted it to YouTube. And so, it is the documentary from their expedition on the Amazon River. And so I reached out to the guy through YouTube and was like, I need this more than you, you know, it's what? I need to convince you to send it to me. And so I was able to get it on eBay from him, which is really cool. So it just arrived yesterday or else I would have,
that's very cool.
Watched it by now, but I am really excited. I do know that their trip was largely, study the, At the time, the large topic was the mining that was occurring along the river, and the kind of the downstream effects that was happening that were occurring because of that. Oh. So I'm expecting that. I think I'll watch this video for. This 2-hour documentary waiting for a Bigfoot Sasquatch video of my dad at some point probably walking into frame on accident, and that's the goal.
That's cool.
Yeah. Someone sent us the book.
That's great.
There's a corresponding book to it, and there are several photos in this book. Where he is legitimately looks like Bigfoot in the background. Where he's just walking by, the blurry Tim Trabon who got it, who managed to get in the shot.
So is that the myth of your father? Is he there or is he not there?
Yeah, maybe. They had some pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing how when I say like, you know, when you describe him as a fish out of water, it's pretty amazing how true that was, but how much he enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
that's very cool. So if you see me hesitant around this area right now, it's because I kind of like the openness of the face and the, you know, without the features. It's that thing where you like what the materials are doing, but you also want to make something that's sort of representative of what you're looking at. Hey, I will say this about these last 19 sessions is that I've gotten a lot more comfortable drawing in front of people again. And and also I'm using pastels more than I ever have. Getting my glasses next week, so I'm really curious to see what the difference is going to be with my drawing. It's a new prescription. Hopefully it'll help.
I just realized my mic was muted. Makes a big difference, Bill. You get good prescription.
Yeah, it's my last prescription was for my astigmatism, but they tell me my astigmatism's gotten better. But my reading prescription, which is also my drawing prescription, has gotten worse. So, I'm looking forward to it.
Well, it's tough. It's like, you know, drawing the figure, that was one of the things that my eyes battled the most, because you got to focus on your board and then you got to look 12 feet away in low light.
Right, exactly.
It's a real challenge.
Yeah, it's exactly. And I thought about doing progressives, but that would just make me crazy. That would give me a headache. And so we'll see how that goes. This is probably the slowest I've drawn anything in a while. So, John, have you found have you been able to adjust to that whole thing of drawing something from a distance while you're wearing your glasses?
No. Does it? It makes it easier for me actually to draw the glasses drawing from photography.
Yeah.
But when you're drawing from the model, there's more information and.
Yeah.
It teaches you how to draw from photography.
There you go.
Okay, Dale and Audrey are here.
All right.
Chris is here too.
Awesome.
Chris is actually in Kansas City. Thanks. Visiting his son.
Who do we have to send a can of WD-40 to for their chair? Is that you, John?
That's me. And the reason I jumped up is because I dropped my pastel and it's underneath my cabinet. It's the only one. I'm on the ground scrambling.
The people, none of the audience can see your video, but they're hearing the audio soundtrack to your current situation. So.
Well, it's not going really well right now.
Yeah.
Damn it. I can't believe that happened.
I'm constantly dropping things and bumping into things. And
Bill, so have you been drawing a lot this week?
What's that?
Have you been drawing a lot this week?
I have been drawing a lot this week. I was trying some different things, like turning the image upside down, draw with my left hand.
Yeah.
Right, so, you know, right side up. I did like four different drawings of Pence.
Well, I'm sure those were expressive.
Is yeah. Well, I got one compliment that they were more expressive than
Maybe they're not maybe expressive isn't the right word. I heard somebody describe him as a translucent gummy bear. I'm trying to remember where I heard that. Oh, I was like, oh man, it's so great. Pete Holmes. You dig that, John. Pete, you know the comedian Crashing? That was his bit. Were those just projects, or just were you just drawing? Just
sketchbook drawings, just to
opening up the news app.
Yeah, just to have try something.
Yeah.
I love new pastels, but I don't like that they're in that sticky paper that you've got to peel.
You know, I haven't often taken a break and just watched people draw during these. It is really fun. I should do this more often.
That's every Thursday night for me, Audrey.
Ah, well, you... You're lucky. Yeah, this is cool. I mean, I was a little late to the game here, but this is very relaxing.
It is. We could totally market this as like a sleepy nap. Right? As long as it's not like me and Ray here, you know, we're not talking too much. It's really probably very calming.
Ooh, cool. Sometimes, like when I'm on speakerphone with my partner, you can like try to guess what kind of material I'm using just based on the background sound. the ASMR.
Oh, totally. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I have good news. I just fixed my pencil sharpener. So I'm going to try to work with colored pencils today after. I thought I was going to have to buy a new unit, but it turned out there was like a special pocket of pencil shavings that I just couldn't see. So it's been like at least a month where I thought I had to get a new one. Wrong. I'm happy now. I didn't have to hear that though.
The pencil sharpener, I mean, that's an exciting thing for our ASMR fans in the audience.
Oh yeah, especially when it's not working. Yeah, for our hardcore fans.
the light sawing sound of the pencil sharpener.
Yeah. We don't shame, whatever you're into.
I swear, there is a video of that we have on YouTube that has like, it's for the Illustration Academy, and it has like a bizarre number of views. I mean, not unusual, but it was enough for us to be like, wow, what's going on with that video? What happened there? It's like a demonstration. And it definitely became popular on a blog for like videos that people watch before going to sleep. Like to fall asleep. Yeah. Yeah. So. And
what was it?
It was I'll pull it up because Alice told me about it. She was like, did you know that Chris Payne demo is like people are watching it to like fall asleep? I was like, that's amazing. It's also a really great demo, but it has, you know, it has two different fan bases.
That's cool.
Yeah. I think it is his video.
Is it the sounds that are relaxing or
I think because it's largely, it's like a demonstration from the Academy. So okay. John just one of our attendees just said it's like Bob Ross. Yeah, it's like really calming. There's not a lot of talking. You can really just hear, you can just hear Chris working. Yeah.
Where are we at on time?
Yeah.
I was just wondering.
John, you're on mute.
You got another minute or two.
Okay. Oh, cool.
Who's up next, by the way?
Well, is Dale here? And Dale and Audrey, you can fight it out. Which one, who wants to go first?
I might be good to go next. Okay. If you don't want to, but I'll volunteer if no one else does.
I'm not set up. I'm still sort of in transit here, so. Not me.
Yeah, I'm kind of excited just because I'm going to try colored pencil, which I haven't done.
Are you guys gonna make me draw tonight? Okay. So Audrey, which photo would you like to draw?
The one that I had picked was the portrait with the is a green radial headpiece.
Yes, great.
That was cool because I remember I had toned this paper, this really bright color, and I was like, oh, that'd be so great to, work on top of because there's so many like the cadmium oranges in the face markings. So we'll go with that one.
Perfect.
I might set out a couple extra things for myself, but water for myself. I guess push that. Let me know when that's up. I'm just pulling out a couple brushes.
If you hit refresh now, you'll be able to see it.
So. All right.
I'm certain that everybody's fallen asleep already. That's what the room sounds like to me right now.
Yeah, we gotta get those YouTube views and yeah.
Okay. So are we good to go? Or are we finishing up the last one?
Yeah, I'm done. I mean, I can.
We're done. Okay.
Are we done? All right. On to the next one. So everybody who just finished drawing, if this is your first night with us, hope you're drawing along. Please share your work with us. You can either share it in the Facebook group. If Instagram is more your speed, just share it with hashtag illustration isolation and tag visual arts passage. We always really like to check out the artwork at the end of the night. Please share.
There.
All right. I'm hoping for a drawing night. Just putting on a little bit of acrylic.
So funny, my arms look so huge here and my hands are tiny. And then
you're like that. Was it Kristen Wiig or the Tiny Hands SNL sketch?
Yeah.
It's like that. There's like a movie or something that's basically like first person video games.
I know what you're talking about.
You know what I'm talking about.
What was that movie called? I really liked it. A lot of people did not like it. It was a pretty polarizing film. So we're gonna.
That's what I got.
Who's drawing tonight? All right, I'm gonna show the room. John, we're gonna stop by your studio.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
I'm still working.
That's fantastic.
Just curious, in the audience, does anybody else in the audience print out the reference?
I think that would be like really healthy for phone. I feel like I put mine on the phone power mode where it doesn't turn off. I'm like, oh, I feel like that's so bad for my battery. It'd be great to do.
Yeah. So if you're joining us, if you just hit refresh, you'll see the newest photo is up and ready to be drawn.
So I think John was smart to work from a black and white photo.
Amira just asked, how about animals? How about them? I gotta assume there's an implication that maybe we could draw animals. John, I've never really asked about that. Do you guys draw animals often?
We certainly can do that.
Do you guys do that? Do you guys do animals too?
We're very trained to say yes.
No,
we can do everything.
Yeah, no. But I'm saying we've never had like an animal night. You know, like a pet portrait night.
I'd be down for that.
A pet portrait night. That'd be cool. I'll do live photography. We could do a themed costume night. We could do a goth. Audrey, this is what we'll do. We'll do a goth night, but with my dogs.
Oh, wow. That would be cool. Amazing.
We call it a pothic.
Yeah. I like the way you're thinking.
Yeah. John, they should have said, I am so down for animal goth night.
Submit your portraits. You know, yeah. I don't know if I was there that night, but how did it go the time where everyone or their people submitted their reference? Did you guys get some cool stuff?
We got, you know, some cool stuff was submitted. Some of it was not submitted in time or the collection was not, some of it was submitted in ways in which we didn't see it until afterwards.
Gotcha.
And then the
everybody final, did a great job. Final it was answer, fun. It was really fun. Yeah.
Yeah. The final answer to that is we did it once.
Yeah, but I don't want to, you know.
No, I don't. I want to try it. I definitely want to try it again.
Victor submitted photography and it was fun. It was a bit more work.
Well, hey, you got to try a new thing.
We got to try it. I think it was fun. Yeah.
No, I remember that was a thing, but that was one of the
we should be stocking it up. Yeah. I am really excited because we have some really awesome, the Wade brothers, their studio, Art House, their rep house, they're lending us or introducing us to some pretty amazing photographers, which I'm going to share a link to the first photographer we will be working with. It's really exciting. Let me pull it up. Brian Rodner Carr. Very cool stuff. Brian Carr. Yeah. Really awesome photography. Is anybody joining us for their first time tonight? Just curious, in the audience. Oh, cool. Few people, that's great. Thanks. I hope you're drawing with us. Awesome. Well, if you're just joining for the first time, I saw somebody. Chris, great to have you back. I just shared the photos if this is your first time. or if you're having trouble remembering where the photos are.
So these are your photos, Timmy?
No, this is photography that my dad took in
your dad, okay.
Early 80s. It's a long story though. I'll save the audience from hearing again, but we kind of contextualized it. But they're all from expedition in the Amazon in the early 80s for a documentary film. With the Cousteau Society. He was kind of his big adventure, his one of many, he has this library of photography. We were talking the other week, because we wanted to move on, to a new photographer, and I'm hoping we'll be able to each month feature a photographer.
I think that's a wonderful idea.
Yeah, and we were waiting for these new introductions to pin out to where we could look through a portfolio, and we were talking last week, and I was like, we should grab some of these photos my dad had, because they're some amazing photos. And it, you know, we also just don't want to just be like grabbing rent. We want to get permission. So, I've been reaching out to a lot of people. I reached out to the Vivian Meyer, I think it's called the Vivian Meyer Foundation, because they'll give permission every once in a while for things like this. And fingers crossed, if everyone sends them an email. But
must be cool to like see some of your dad's work in a you know, fresh light, new interpretations.
Oh yeah, it's so cool. I mean, it's really special to like look through the photography, because it's really very apparent that, I mean, it was like such an incredible experience that he was having, and it was like when you put it in the context of time, the era that it was in, and the things that he had access to then, it was pretty amazing that he was able to kind of manifest that for himself and like figure out how to make that possible.
So he was out here doing this in the 80s. What did you think of that as a kid?
I wasn't around. In the early 80s. I'm not that old, Audrey.
No, but,
what was the story for me? It was really inspiring. It's a really good question,
I mean, even the stuff, you know, when you were young, neither of my kids, or not my kids, I'm sorry, my parents are visual artists. So I always am like fascinated by what people gathered when they grew up around parents who were visual artists.
I did not realize that he was a skilled photographer until he got an Instagram account and started sharing the photos from his trips when he was young.
Because that's kind of hilarious.
He started to scan these slides, and he was really good. He never got any sort of training. He was like self-taught, but he took a lot of, I mean, the photos chosen tonight, like I don't know that they even do him justice, as far as like, he has a few photos from that era that are just like, it's like kind of mind boggling that it goes beyond like a lucky photo where you're just like, you know, if you take a million photos, like, you know, a broke clock is right twice a day situation, you know?
Okay.
But it gets to a point where you look at all the photos you took and you're like, wow, he had a way about like capturing people in their element. And for whatever reason, I think they just got comfortable around him. Cause I can't do that. When I would like try to take like I did photojournalism in college for a newspaper, like what should be like the easiest photojournalist job you could possibly ever get? And like, I could be like in a like public event, and if I like snapped a photo, like people would stop and all look at me, you know, like that. Like I don't know how people do that well. Like they like blend in and capture a moment, fly on the wall. He was really good at it. He has like a collection of like hundreds of photos that are like, whoa, amazing. And I don't know, for whatever reason. I mean, also I think that that's kind of like, I don't know. I did not know until he was like on Instagram.
That's
really
interesting.
Yeah. I mean, I knew he's definitely creative, and he was like creative with, like he was always doing creative and fun things, but yeah, it did not click. Cause I was working, you know, I wanted to be a photographer, and I thought that it was like, maybe I was like too heady about it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, he's really good at it.
Well, I'm always interested to hear.
Yeah, John, you can correct me. I mean, like his dream was to like, or his like plan, like he met your dad, John, because he wanted to print, he wanted to make reprints for artists, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
I love listening to my dad never told the story this way, but your dad always did. He said, I met your dad, and the first thing I did, he was a printer in his basement.
Yeah.
He was working in his basement. He was 26 or 27 years old, 27, I guess, in 77. And he said the first thing he did was I had to check your dad out and make sure he was of quality enough to work with me.
Yeah. He had no idea.
That's how little I knew about the world.
I think it was Noel Gordon at Hallmark. I think it was Noel Gordon at Hallmark was like, there's this illustrator, I'll introduce you. He's like, well, I'm gonna need to check him out first. Send me his work. Yeah, let me see some of his work before we move things forward. But yeah,
your dad liked to tell stories on himself too. So I love listening to him.
Oh man, yeah. Well, he had your dad helped him get in with the Cousteaus, and the story was like, I should outline it. I'll butcher it tonight. There's too many moving parts, and you and I have different versions of it, John. So we have to get our story on the same page for the because it also involves a public figure. It also involves both of them, both of them wronging Ted Turner. So we gotta outline our story before we share it publicly.
Got it.
Yeah, but it's they got into like a lot of pretty funny situations. I remember, John, you were with me when your dad told me about the first time they met John Denver, and
oh, nice.
They were at this bar, and they they were. They were trying to rub shoulders. They wanted John Denver to like him, and because that he was their in with the Cousteaus. Your dad was already in with them, probably. I mean,
he had done his several album covers for him at that time already.
But it sounded like your dad was like, you know, we were trying to convince him of this idea we had where I was gonna do these illustrations of Jacques Cousteau, and we needed John Denver to pitch it to Cousteau, and he goes, and this guy. approaches John Denver at the bar, and this guy's had a couple of drinks, and he's having a fan moment that he's, you know, sees John Denver, right? And John Denver, you know, he's like, can I get your autograph? And John Denver's like, you know, I'm very flattered, but I'm having drinks with my friends. If you could, you know, be a bit like, not right now. Very politely says, not right now. And the guy was like, come on, John. And Mark goes, and so me and your dad were like, let's take this guy out. Like, we got to protect our buddy, John. Like, you know, they were like the Midwest to the bar, you know, and they were like, didn't you hear John? He said, get out of here, you know? And John Denver was like, whoa, 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 no, he's fine. No, I'll give you an autograph. You know,
don't beat up my fans.
Yeah, don't beat up my fans. No. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's hilarious.
So, Audrey, how are you liking the colored pencils?
It was a good start. I don't usually sketch out that way, but I forget how nice of subtlety you can get. Sometimes it takes these, you know, these shorter exercises to like make me brave enough to pull out some materials for other work. So now that they're out, maybe my next project will get some kind of pencils on it too.
No, I hear what you said. I'm just trying to not make this look like a bonnet, which to mine looks like a baby bonnet right now, which is not.
Though I was one of those kids in high school that was insane with the colored pencils. Like that was my jam. That was how I started off in illustration. It was my go-to. I would cover gigantic pieces of paper, like it would take months to finish the pieces, and
that's how I passed. Have you ever tried them with lighter fluid?
No. What does that do?
It melts them into like a watercolor thing. There's a Bill Sienkiewicz demo, I think, where he does something like that. But I guess if you use lighter fluid, like, you know, lighter, like a big, you know, a lighter, not charcoal lighter fluid. Anyways, it melts them down, and you can get this sort of watercolor effect.
Interesting.
I haven't tried it, but
I wonder who's the first person to find that. Huh? I'm gonna give that a go.
that's beautiful.
Which one?
Yours is it's gorgeous.
Really nice.
Thank you.
Yours is looking amazing.
Thank you. I hope it continues to be working out.
Stopping by your studio, Bill, to see what you're up to.
Hey. I started black and white, and then I switched it to color.
Oh, nice. Is that a strategy you take often?
Most of the time, if I start black and white, I'll make up my own color. But when I popped over to Audrey's screen, I saw the beautiful color in it. I got curious as to what the color was in the photo.
Yeah.
So I flipped the photo back to color. But sometimes, you know, wow.
John, stopping by your studio. And Laura has a question. How much time is left on this one? Trying to decide if I should start it or wait for the next one. What do you think? Should Laura...
You got 41 seconds, Laura.
Laura, quick. Quick, Laura.
Wow, that's gorgeous.
Yeah. If very cool. Audrey, I love yours. That's so great. The color is awesome.
Thank you. Helped to start off with that base for sure. Glad I had it ready. I didn't even know it would be the right color.
That's really beautiful.
Lee asks, any individual name or tribe people for this one? Same people, tribe, but I don't know the individual. Unfortunately, a lot of the photos I don't know the individual. I only knew the Chief Rayone of the Kayapo people. So I'm not sure. I wish I knew. I should add, though, since just doing a little bit of research, learning a little bit more, you can hear my skittish dog in the background. She's a little jumpy. No, I just did a little bit of research on our Chief Rayone of the Kayapo people, and I did not realize this, but was recently a candidate for the 2020 Nobel Peace Prize, which is amazing.
Wow.
Namely for a lifetime of work protecting the Amazon forest, rainforest.
And your dad discovered him. Unbelievable.
I would say, yeah, I know. Chief Rayone ended up meeting a lot more people than my dad. if you look, you'll see he's had a life of working with some of the most iconic people in the world. It's pretty unbelievable.
Gotta start somewhere.
Yeah. I would not be surprised if the Cousteaus were a few of the first. But, you know, at the time, Jacques Cousteau was one of the most recognized humans on the planet, you know? Right. So it's like, that was no small... Chief Rayone was connected. Yeah.
It was a good start.
Yeah. Starting with Jacques Cousteau is a big one. So... here's a question from Deb. Audrey, what materials are you using? Prismacolor and?
I haven't worked this way on this cam on like this event before, but yeah, essentially just that. It's a toned piece of just Bristol board with a mixture of gesso and acrylic on it. And then I am building up with colored pencil and a little bit, I just to fill in some of these areas. Acrylic, but I only have about like three colors of acrylic, super limited, but it allows me to think detailed when I want to, or like that, the mark that a pencil makes, like the little tiny renderings like I'm doing under the chin, and then it allows me to put in broad strokes when I don't want to be rendering everywhere. So a palette of colors, a palette of marks. I was really trying to focus on a bit of likeness for this one, since I think
okay. It's
really nice.
Okay, John, has it been 45 seconds?
Oh yeah, we're done.
I figured.
Yeah.
Cool. Who's up next?
Dale or me? I'll go.
All right, John.
I don't mind going. I'm my drawing board camera is on a different computer, though, so you have to pluck me out of the audience here, Timmy.
Oh yeah. Sorry
about that, Dale. But either way, it
doesn't matter. Do you want to close down the night?
Sure, I'll try to put on my best Gil Ashby voice.
Yeah.
Take us out, nice and relaxed.
Tell me a story, Dale.
Yeah, tell us a story, Dale. Yeah, cool. John, what image would you like to go with?
The portrait, straight on shot with the guy with the beard.
Yeah. I've always identified with this photo because we both have the same shoulder hair.
What a beautiful detail.
You'll see it and you'll go, oh wow, Timmy.
Kind of, I played with the first one a lot longer. I drew through the whole second pose. I'm trying to use something I haven't done before, using charcoal to start with a black charcoal, and didn't get done, but it was, that's what I'm gonna try on this one too.
See
what
happens.
So you can see where I got to.
So if you hit refresh, you'll see the newest photo is up. Let me show the gallery view. Cool. Audrey, that's so great. Love it.
Beautiful, Audrey.
Yeah. Definitely interested in these photos.
Man, and George is texting. He's texting me his photos.
Who is?
George is. They're so great.
He's been doing that to me too.
I wish you could you in webinar rooms you cannot share images as text messages. I wish you could, or I would text them to everyone. But if in between drawings, please share your work. I'd love to see the second drawing. Share it to the Facebook group or go to Instagram and do hashtag illustration isolation and tag at Visual Arts Passage.
So I guess I'll try to explain what I'm doing a little. Are you sharing can you see my screen?
Yeah, we're doing a whole group, but I'm gonna jump to it. Here we go. Now we're there.
All right, so I'm using a compressed charcoal, really soft, and it's extremely active. I mean, you touch the paper and it goes pure black almost immediately. And I'm just trying to find my way around, as I always do, trying to find a shape of the head. And let's see. This will look awful for a while, and it may look awful even after a while.
Remember, the paper is the only one taking the risk, right?
That's right. And the fact that you're doing it on camera.
Oh, yeah, and your reputation.
Yeah.
I forgot about that.
I've never liked that thing where it's like, you're only as good as the last thing you've done.
Oh.
Like, that sucks.
I feel like that's such a mean, like, inner voice, like, way to talk to yourself. I recently found some sketchbooks from, like, middle school and high school, and I remember feeling the opposite way. Like, I don't know, because I guess I never really asked anyone's opinion, and I always felt like I'm as good as my best drawing or my favorite drawing, and I just have to, like, catch up to that, you know, like, increase my batting average, but, like, I'm really that good. Like, yeah. I don't know, I tried to, like, say nice things to myself when I was new at it.
I posted something I did almost 30 years ago. People are like, wow, that's amazing. You know, inside I go, what about the stuff I'm doing now?
Two things can be good at once. Yeah.
Yeah, it only lasts for, you know. But I'm torn. I've got the guy's face and John's video up side by side because I like watching John draw. I like watching everybody draw. Yeah.
And it's funny that I'll go through all this, I'll draw all this stuff, and then I pretty much blur it out completely. But things got to be in the right place before I can blur it out.
Yeah, Ashley is the queen of that. I love when she goes over her whole drawings.
Timmy, I have a question for you.
Oh, I think Timmy left.
Oh. I can pretend.
Yeah, I'll stand in for Timmy. What's your question, Bill?
Oh, my question for Timmy was just asking him if he ever feels like drawing, you know.
Oh, he always does, but he's afraid to in this forest of tall trees. Any other, and does anybody else have any questions for Timmy? Oh, he's gone. I'm happy to answer for him.
Yeah, I'm going to have you speak for me next time too, because I think.
Does anyone have any questions for Bill? I'd be happy to help you out with that.
You can answer those too.
I step away for 1 minute and I hear somebody saying, does anybody else have any other questions for Timmy?
Timmy, you got that last answer?
Very afraid.
I'm like, whoa.
Your last answer was brilliant.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I'm sure.
I'm gonna have to think about that for a while.
If anybody was offended by my last answer, you can write us at john@visualartspassage.com.
I think for that one, it would be Dale at Visual Arts Passage.
Yeah.
That might be a, yeah. That email might bounce.
John, I already love your drawings. Like, you have a really sensitive touch, which I envy.
Oh, that's lovely.
You know, Bill, what I really love is your enthusiasm. Oh, man. Because it's a ways from loving it yet.
I just have a music teacher who said, just play the notes. And that really is what you know, this sort of drawing is, right?
Yeah.
The notes are all right there.
Dale, are you a guitarist?
I am, or I was.
It's not
what happened. But you're still something. There wasn't like an incident, like you still have all your fingers and
Yeah. What the incident was coming face to face with you know, it's not as painful as I'm making it sound. I'm just trying to put it correctly.
Build it up.
There was a point at, here. Let's make this about me. There was a point at which I had to make a decision.
Yeah.
You know, continue on and see if I could make that work, or I was already making a living as a cartoonist at the time. And we were opening for this very popular Boston band, and I was more like an 80s shredder. You know what I mean?
Were you just another band out of Boston? Is that
on the road and try to make ends meet. Yeah.
That's right. Living in your cars.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I grew up in the town where Boston rehearsed, and we used to hear them at recess. And of course, the way you rehearse is, you know, you start a song, you get to a point, you stop, you say, let's do that better, you know, like any other kind of practice. But we didn't know what was going on, so we were like, these guys suck. They can't even get through a song. So anyway, I came up against someone who was truly talented, and I realized that's what I wanted to do, and I was never going to do that. You know what I mean? It was like,
yeah.
It was like a really good, you know, street basketball player suddenly meeting LeBron, and just, you know, you realize, okay, that's not what I do. So it was a relief, actually. You know, like it was kind of tough, and then it was like, okay, I'm glad that happened.
What would be, how would you describe, you said you're an 80s shredder. I've got all these ideas in my head of, I'm thinking like, when you say shred, are you talking about like?
Yeah.
Are you thinking metal?
No, metal. Yeah, yeah. And not metal like today. You know, 80s metal compared to today's metal is, you know, it's
like soft rock.
Soft rock. No. We were
like Def Leppard.
Yeah. We're like a. It's funny. We were kind of educated though, so it was more like Toto trying to be Van Halen.
Oh, I would see that.
So it was, you know, good chops, interesting time signatures. But really, none of the. You know, sex.
Yeah. Did you have the hair though?
Oh, hell yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I had.
Whoa, I mean, how much harder you had the hair, you could play guitar. You were like 90% there.
Exactly. What else do you need? That's what I was saying.
Yeah.
What else do I have to do?
It's cool that you had that, though.
That was awesome. It taught me so much. It gave me such a leg up on becoming a freelancer because, you know, we're an all original band. So we had to market our own stuff and promote. I was really the marketer, the promoter, I was booking the gigs, getting paid. And that's a thing. You don't leave the club before you get paid. So like, even now I still have that impulse. Like, no. I'm getting paid. I'm not leaving till I get paid. And you know, you're paying me in money, you know?
So, right.
So it was a good, it was a good experience. Yeah. I feel bad for kids today because there doesn't seem to be a music scene like there was back then.
Well, not right now.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, now not, especially.
But,
yeah.
But like not as romantic, right? I don't know.
Yeah.
Because like the SoundCloud, in ways, it's more accessible than it ever has been.
Right. And it's there's a huge music scene online, but it's people playing in their bedrooms. I saw this amazing video of, I don't know if you know who Steve Vai is, but he's an incredible guitar player.
Yeah.
And he's a little older than me, so he's probably 60, I think. But you know, when I was coming up, he was the man. And I saw this video of him. He was doing something like everybody else is today in his bedroom. And I just thought, wow, imagine if you could go back and give little Steve Vai, 15-year-old Steve Vai, just a 10-second glimpse of his future. He would have seen himself, first of all, completely destroying the guitar, just doing amazing work, but in his bedroom, you know what I mean? And, or his, not his bedroom, but his basement studio. Mm-hmm. So he probably would have been like, I'm amazing and I never made it out of the house.
Oh yeah, I didn't even think about it that way.
Right?
Yeah, why am I doing this?
Exactly. Did I get a job? Am I a music teacher? What happened?
Yeah. Oh no.
Yeah. Screw this. I'm not doing this.
Yeah. I saw this was like early in the quarantine. What's his name of Tears for Fears? Kurt Smith of Tears for Fears. He posted a video of him and his daughter doing a cover of Mad World.
Oh yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, I loved it. It was great. But yeah, it was really, that is like kind of we're in a weird, especially now, like where production is like so much more accessible. But yeah, I know you're talking about like the romantic idea of like going out and it not everything having to happen all.
Yeah,
where the results were not numbers of likes, right?
Well, the likes were, you know, in some places the dislikes were the beer bottles that were being thrown and the likes.
That's so cool that you have that as a.
Oh hell yeah! The zoo.
That's so great.
The zoo in Manchester, New Hampshire, was a biker bar.
You had beer bottles thrown at you?
Oh yeah. It was right out of it was like directly out of the Blues Brothers. They had the chicken wire in front of the stage, and I remember the first time we played there, we were like, what?
That's so cool.
Yeah, and it actually was cool. You know, it's very, very scary, but in retrospect.
Oh, but I gotta imagine it's a rush though.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like rock climbing. Like if it wasn't a little dangerous.
Yeah. And it was especially cool when they actually liked you, because then it was just. Yeah.
They still threw beer bottles at you.
Well, they were to you, not at you.
There's a ginger throw. Yeah.
Timmy, I got to ask, is your hair, your back really this hairy, man? This is...
Oh, you know, I didn't even talk about back, but, you know, I was just getting on the shoulders. Yeah, that's one of the many things I inherited from my father.
I was listening to you guys earlier. I was making dinner for the family, and we had dinner in Detroit, and you guys were talking about your father. I could listen to stories about your father all day, man. He sounds like the coolest guy.
Oh, he was.
Yeah.
I wish you could have met him, Dale. It was
me too.
You guys would have spent a lot of time together talking.
And those pictures, like that picture when he was a little older, sitting with the in the cowboy hat.
Yeah.
That was just beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, and he never stopped.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Well, that's nice. You were close to him right up till the end.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, a lot of people were.
It's nice. Today's my father's 93rd birthday.
Oh, congrats there, man.
Well, it's nice. But difficult family situation. We've been estranged for a few years, and he has dementia. So it's kind of like my brothers and I lost him a while ago. But I really love, like, John, your relationship with your father, and Timmy, I just it really makes me happy to hear about those relationships, and like I really make an effort to have that with my kids.
Oh yeah, well, you know, it's I think I learned a lot about, like, you know, I had a relationship with my dad like probably anybody has with their dad, where it's, there's always the father-son conflict of the toxic masculinity of father-son relationship. Me and him are so like, we were so like-minded, or people tell me that. We've been talking about him for so long and so positively, it sounds like I'm patting myself on the back, but we had very similar personality types. And so, oh man, yeah, we could go at it. You know, it's like, if he was here right now, it'd be like all hugs and tears for 5 minutes, and then we'd find something to disagree on. But no, it's relationships. I mean, like family, especially like father sons. It's really difficult, you know. I read a thing. I'm trying to remember what. Some author wrote it. They were like, it isn't until your dad dies you realize every argument you ever had with him, you were wrong.
Oh my God, I know.
Yeah.
I know.
It's not totally true. It's just, whatever it feels. It feels true though. I think that was what the author was trying to say, is it can feel true. And there's a lot of bad, you know, that comes with a certain relationship you have with your dad. Not everybody can say that, but he was.
I like this. This went from very light to really heavy.
Illustration isolation.
Right.
Well, we want to make sure you feel extra. This is on. Total isolation.
The dad episode.
The dad episode.
The episode where they talk about that. The one where they talk about that.
Yeah.
Well, if my father would be here, I would hear, what are you doing?
What's going on with that?
What was that all about? What are you doing?
What do you mean Timmy's in the computer? He's in the computer.
Really funny.
Yeah.
Well, you can see obviously that I work from very out of focus to into focus.
Wow.
Hopefully.
Yeah. No, Dale, I don't mean to be too heavy. I do like to try and be like relatively honest
here. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think I started it, so if I brought the room down, I apologize.
I really appreciate the genuine conversation. I really do. I love hearing about y'all.
I'm glad. Thank you.
Oh, thanks, Audrey.
Well, I'm taking 2 more minutes before I'm done, and I'm going to call them. I would call them Timmy minutes, but I'm going to call them Dale minutes tonight.
Oh, wow. Why? Oh, that's right. Well,
you talked the whole time through my, which was fine. It took the pressure off of me.
Oh, man.
But I want to just take a couple minutes here because I can put some lights in here real quick and explain what I'm doing.
Well, I'm going to hop around the room really quickly.
I painted over one of my old paintings.
I'm going to use everybody else's as reference.
Reference.
Oh, wow. That's nice.
Nice.
That is awesome.
Drop the paintbrush.
Dale, we're stopping by your studio. Are you in Boston right now?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Boston proper or outside of Boston?
No, I live in Foxborough. Yeah. We're 30 miles south. What's that?
And you've got a little bit of a garden, right?
Yard
that you take care of. I've heard about the summer yard work.
Oh, you do? What? How? Is that?
I think through Facebook.
Is there like a Reddit site on that?
There's a Reddit site on Dale Stefanos' backyard.
Look at this.
I've been refreshing it, waiting on updated photos.
I gotta check that out.
You're like another sailor at sea, isn't that the phrase?
Yeah.
Because I spend a lot of time in my yard right now. That's what I think has become my quarantine hobby, has been my backyard.
It's nice, isn't it?
Oh, it's so great.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. We finally set up a screen. And we're watching we've been watching the Red Sox games back there at night.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's awesome. Great. We started doing that too. That's hilarious. We have like a little projector.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it's so much fun. We're not watching Red Sox games though.
Well, they lost like 18-5 or something tonight. So I don't think anybody.
So
watched.
You're like, I guess I'm going to go draw.
Screw it. I'm miserable anyway.
So do they play for no audience or?
There's no audience, but they have audience sounds.
Yeah.
So, the ball gets hit and the crowd cheers. And what I wanted, what's that?
It's like they're playing for ghosts.
Yes. You know what?
That must be exciting. Yeah.
I said that to one of my kids. It's like, this is like the laugh tracks. You know, a lot of these people are no longer with us.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
That's where I usually end up.
Right. Oh, yeah.
Well, we can go on. Dale, you're up next. We can go on anytime.
That looks good, John. I have to find a picture.
Wow. You know, the crowd sounds though, I thought that the laugh tracks were really stupid until I watched Late Night without a laugh track. And then it was like, oh wow,
That laugh track is important.
You know who's been doing that pretty well is
can I guess?
I think
Jimmy Fallon did a pretty good job. Cause his band his band is there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was that your thought?
No, I was going to say Bill Maher. I think he just came back and he's just like they're just embracing it. So like they're going for like the applause and then they show the audience and it's a scene from like at one point it was Robert De Niro from Cape Fear laughing, you know, smoking a cigar in the movie theater and he's laughing obnoxiously.
That's
like a 40s scene, so you know, black and white. So they're kind of embracing it and just having fun.
Yeah, that definitely addresses the elephant in the room. With Fallon, it's just like, what's that, Audrey?
It's incorporating it more.
Yeah. Do it.
Yeah, I think like the first ones of like Seth Meyers and Fallon, it was just like silent and they would just pause and you'd be like, oh, you're like staring at your phone like, oh, I guess I'm supposed to laugh now.
I thought Colbert was like really exposed. It just like he's so set up for an audience and it's just not happening at all.
Because he plays like he used to play like that character.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
I always forget about the character. Yeah.
Yeah, like he's actually I don't know if he still does that, but like he was like a character on his show previously.
Dale, did you say, do they have, because a few people have messaged about the people cutouts. Do they have people cutouts?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I've got a friend who you can pay for your seat. I have a friend who you know, paid to have his cutout put up there.
Oh, man. Yeah.
A friend with too much money.
Yeah. Well, a friend who never had kids and, you know.
Yeah.
So.
In one dream at a time.
Exactly. One dream. I like that. I really like that.
Yeah, a few people have said that they have Weekend at Bernie's at
the Royal.
At the house.
They have Bernie in the stands right behind home plate.
Yeah. Looking good, John.
Yeah, I'm having fun with it.
Well, whenever...
Let's go on, Dale, you're up.
I was just going to say, I've got the photos up.
So what's left? Is it the one with the two kids?
It's up to you. It's dealer's choice, Dale. I actually, John, I added a second photo as well.
Okay.
Dale.
I'm going by the text. I only saw the ones...
Oh, I'm sorry, Dale. I meant like on the webpage. If you go to the webpage, don't worry about it. Go with the photo film if you'd like.
No, I'd rather let me do this. Sorry. Oh boy.
No problem.
Oh boy, here I am on stage. Oh no, that's cool. I love
you're stumbling. One. You're stumbling to accept your award.
Yeah. Hello everybody. Ooh. Oh, this is cool. I'll take this one with the textures here with the
it's a lot
it's a lot. You got to choose which bite you want to take. All right, I'm gonna try it. I have no idea how to go about this.
Now we've been streaming like old movies in our backyard, but not Chris Payne old movies, not the movies that he thinks are classics.
Oh, you mean like
back the to ones? The... Yeah, we're going back to like a few years before I was born,
like '90s.
Like
you just had to Google Weekend at Bernie's.
No, I grew up on Weekend at Bernie's. That's Weekend at Bernie's was a staple. When he falls out of the speedboat, I watched that just recently, just
dying laughing. Yeah. No, we did Jurassic Park recently, which I'm sure my neighbors now know about. It was a bold first outdoor movie to choose for like late night showing with like, you know, cause we set up cause I live not too far from a highway. So we had to set up speakers and it was an aggressive neighborly move to make. Yeah.
What do you use for speakers? Just a Bluetooth?
I used to do a lot of editing. And so I have these like editing suite speakers that these guys gave me that I used to edit on. So they're like pretty great. I have no use for them now, like for my computer. I mean, they're overkill for anything else. I don't even know what model they are. There's something that they're not a known, like they're not anything cool to write home about, but they are very loud. So
that's where the cool comes.
Yeah, right.
I see you have guitars and basses hanging up there. Are you active musician?
Man, Dale, if you're gonna say you're not a musician,
what was your thing?
Oh, I loved I grew up like loving I was really into punk rock when I was in high school. Got into The Clash, The Ramones, all that stuff, like old punk rock.
Yeah.
Not old punk rock, but the staples, I would say. Somebody told me if I got good at bass guitar, I'd be able to play with other people easier because nobody wants to be a bass guitarist. But the one oversight was I still had to be good at bass. And I don't think I ever got good at it. So I never really got to the stage where like I like, you know, would like jam with like a group enough to bridge that gap, you know?
Yeah.
And so I've just like always played. It's always been something that I just do on my own and hang out and do. I've never been like, I would be petrified to play with other people. Which is like a huge shame. Yeah.
Yeah. It's such fun, but it's a lot like what this is doing, you know, what we're doing here tonight. It's, the huge difference of course is that none of us have to be in sync with anybody else here. We're just doing our thing.
Yeah. I got invited to a lot of like band like jam sessions where they'd be like, yeah, come play. And then I'd like come and I'd be like, so you guys came together again next week? And they're like, maybe.
I like the commitment.
They're like, we all need to talk about you when you're not around to decide if we're gonna let that happen again.
We've discovered a weak link.
I am one to believe that there have been many bands that have had conversations about me when I'm not in the room.
Oh, wow. Nice. That's fantastic.
I just never was that good.
Timmy Trebon, the most talked about bass player in town.
The most talked about bass player at my high school.
That's funny.
Yeah.
He's a bass player, but does he play bass?
I always thought it was cool. You know, I've already talked about this here before, but like I watched the documentary about the Beastie Boys.
And I keep meaning to see that.
I just think it's so cool that like it just seemingly, I don't know if they're just very modest, but it seemingly seems true that they were not good musicians at first.
No.
But they were none really of the punk, bad at first, you know?
Yeah, none of the punk guys were, and none of the, it wasn't about musicianship.
But like they started at the same level, it seems like, because they, in my opinion, they got much better as they, I mean, maybe that was more of production happening behind the scenes that I don't understand, but yeah, Robert Hunt.
Were they ever musicians?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Some of their later albums is some of some really great stuff. Where they did, I'd butcher kind of articulating the way that they blended genres and how they kind of, but a lot of that also goes into like hip hop, Dale, where it's like, it is like a production conversation, I think, more than it is like, but I don't know. I think like the song Sabotage, I think that's great.
Oh, it's awesome. I love the Beast Boys. I think they're
really,
they're really groundbreaking in a lot of ways.
But like half of the documentary is dedicated to them being like so upset that they got like brainwashed into doing like frat boy, like beer chugging, fight for your right to party music, you know?
Oh, no kidding. So were they like back on Rick Rubin and all that, or?
I think that they wrote it. They rode the wave and were like having fun, and they meant it. Their intentions were for it to be like satire, and it quickly it was satirical until they got to like their first few shows, and they realized that their audience was frat boys, right? And 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 so they were. I think they were kind of ashamed of it, and they wanted to be recognized as more as less
like real,
like mindless. They wanted I think to be recognized as thoughtful musicians or thoughtful artists.
That's tough.
Yeah.
You know, when you start
I mean, they really doubled down on the frat. The beer chugging partiers that they were.
Yeah, I think they're pretty effective.
Yeah, they did a good job. Hey Dale, if you angle your camera just a little bit to your left, further over your shoulder, it'll be
like this.
Yeah, it's catching your ear a little bit. There you go.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Here's a question from Pierre. Dale, is that graphite powder? What's the tool?
What is this now? Yes. No, this is charcoal powder. This is a pan pastel. What do we call this? Like a fake, like a sponge palette knife kind of thing. I'll show you how you buy them. There it is. So that's what it is. If you want to get that.
Oh, cool.
That code. Order today. It's just a good way to get stuff on the paper. I usually just use my fingers, but it's hot in here. Yeah, my hands are a little sweaty, so I don't want to start doing all that. It's weird. I don't know how to go about it. I'm interested to see how everyone goes at this whatever this is, this headdress thing. That's intimidating. Why did I pick this picture?
Somebody just said, I'm jumping ship. I'm going to draw the kids.
I'm just going to stick it out here. You know what?
Yeah.
Go down in flames. That's what I had. I'm a huge fan of going down in flames. Well, let's see.
You're in the right.
That's great. That would be a fun special episodes, we just get reference photos that are just, there's just no way to succeed with them. And just, you just, the whole theme of it is just watching amazing artists just just face plant.
Yeah, find your way out.
Yeah. Oh, find your way out. I like that. Yeah.
Of course, like, you know, Audrey or Chris Payne or any number of you people would just completely destroy it. Be left here with like chicken scratch.
I don't know if it could be possible. I think it would be, I don't know how we would do it, but it would be interesting to have like a video themed night where our reference is like, you know, obviously something moving.
That'd be like, what do you have in mind? That's a cool concept.
I think, I mean, like, think of like a video of a ballet performance, you know, where you have it streaming. And I mean, I'm thinking out loud, but you know, I always do that way when I'm drawing from a celebrity likeness or from animals. Like I'll tune into videos of them versus versus still photos. I mean, look, I'm thinking out loud here, but I was, you know,
I'm gonna do a poll, Audrey. See, should we do a video night? We'll do a poll.
I'm gonna watch.
Especially like a dance performance or something like that.
I'm gonna watch you guys do that.
Yeah, I don't know how it would go. I've never
done it. Let's make it more difficult. Let's do that.
Well, that was the thought.
Yeah, not hard enough. It'll be. Yeah, Audrey's like this. I'm getting bored of this, guys.
No.
Hey, let's make it hard. Video night. Should we have a video night? I like the idea of a dance. Yeah, something like that. Also,
says the guy who's not drawing.
Yeah, I like this. And so it says, it's also going to mean that I probably don't have to talk at all. Which,
well, also it would be interesting to have it be like a more gesture night than like a long pose. Like if you stream the ballet, you could do more sequential drawings.
I'm gonna make the poll titled, "Do you like Audrey's idea?"
I'm not gonna look. I'm wearing like the best thing for my self-esteem is to like never ask a personal question to an audience about myself.
Oh no!
I'm sorry. Come on.
No.
I was like.
No, I'm being self.
Well, I'm gonna let panelists vote on it. And I'm gonna preface the poll with if John and I and Audrey think it's a good idea, we're gonna do it.
Mm-hmm.
I just like telling you that.
You don't get to vote.
If I'm sitting here for 3 hours, I'm getting
if you vote, you have to draw.
Hey, I'll draw. I got no ego.
You have no expectations.
Really. Yeah, no expectations, man. I could draw. Also, I was pretty loose on the poll. The answers were yes, and the second one was, I'm not sure. Yeah, that's fun.
It's fun.
I like that. John, you don't get to vote. Thanks, Dad.
Yeah, you guys don't get to use Zoom then.
Well,
yeah.
I'm turning my camera off then.
Yeah, yeah. All right.
That looks cool, Audrey.
Fun.
Thanks. I just kind of like blurred it out, and now I'm going to try to focus on sections. I decided not to do the last post so I could put a little more time. Sometimes you just get excited about one.
Yeah.
And sometimes you don't.
Yeah.
Sometimes you get into it and then you realize, uh-oh.
What happened?
Yeah,
a lot of people participated in the poll.
What's the consensus?
Audrey has a good idea, is the consensus.
Okay.
That doesn't mean anything though.
It still has
to go through the John. It still has to go through the John English committee.
Now, Audrey, you don't get to vote.
We're going to talk afterwards, okay?
Audrey knows how to get an idea. She knows how to get an idea though through all the red tape is present it publicly.
Oh,
like that.
Yeah. Because like now we have to do it. Now we have to do it because the people want it.
The people. I like that. The people.
Yeah. No, I'm just teasing.
That's cool, Dale.
What's that?
That was great.
Oh. Oh, thank you. Oh, it looks more like Jimi Hendrix right now, but.
That's not a bad thing.
No, oh, it's fine with me.
I forgot that my window was open as the sun went down, and my little girl who lives next door just knocked at my window and waved through the darkness and scared me. neighbors.
Laura says, I can barely draw these poses, but I'm not going to be here next week, so go ahead and go for it.
That's funny. Oh my God, I just realized I'm busy.
Yeah, everybody in the chat group be like, yeah. I'll be there next week.
Did you guys ever see the, you guys know who Mark Ryden is, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Did you guys see the ballet that he did the concept art for?
No.
Oh.
It was wonderful. It was something that was like candy themed. So it really went well with this pop surrealism, but that was just incredible to see an illustrator get to have full artist. You know, it was very like, you know, what you would expect of like a film art tour, but just like from ballet. And I was like, of course he would have this opportunity. This is so cool.
Right. Yeah. What was the name of it?
Let me look it up. It probably is easy. Something to do with sugar.
Is it the Nutcracker?
That has to do with sugar.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, that's funny. That'd be funny if that's what it was.
No. It was called Whipped Cream.
Oh, that makes sense for him, doesn't it?
Yeah, and it was like all of his kind of iconic characters, like the bears with the wide faces and the, you know.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, and there's a whole concept art book that goes with it, but I've never, he does things that I get so excited to see somebody have such a full body of like experience beyond actually, you know, just painting work for shows and stuff. You know, just the experiences that he has. Even building his studio.
Audrey, I was totally, I had that in my mind, I processed what you said, like the inversion of it, where I thought that he made concept art from a ballet. Just totally butchered it in my head. I'm looking online now. I see exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's just incredible to see. I mean, it was a couple years back, but
is it Nutcracker based on this guy's concept art? That's what I was implying. No, I thought it was dedicated. I thought like he made concept art dedicated toward like or focused on the Nutcracker.
No,
I see exactly what you're talking about now. That is really amazing.
Yeah, it's just an experience that you don't always hear about for an illustrator.
You can hear me listening to it in the background, sorry.
Oh, now I want to listen to Christmas music.
I just shared it.
I just made a Halloween playlist today. Very excited.
Oh, yeah?
I stepped foot into a store, which I rarely do now, and I saw that Halloween candy is already out.
Oh, yeah.
Like, oh, wow.
They have those Halloween stores are up and running.
Someone explained it to me as they're just trying to offload stuff.
Because
it is not going to be traditional this year.
Yeah. That, and also I think having a holiday that does have a lot to do with creativity, you have to give like crafters time to make the stuff. For people like at Michael's, I always understand with that.
Oh yeah.
For people who are like into wreath building, it's like, oh well, I guess you got to get started on that if that's your thing.
Season Audrey, before. Do you costumes for Halloween?
Yeah, I do. Some years have been duds recently, but others have been hits. So I'm usually like one of the extremes, like a really good one, or I forgot. Yeah.
We've had a few off years at my house, but Gianna is like I saw like a video from her childhood of like a Halloween party, and it was like, oh, now it makes sense. This was nurtured at a very young age. She's obsessed with Halloween, so.
Yeah, my family like also like every year, except for some where like a family emergency was going on.
Right.
Had, like always do one. I even like flew home from college a couple times to go to one of my family's parties because it's bigger than like Thanksgiving or Christmas. So.
Nice.
Yeah, a little less pressure too, because I think it's nice to have the big holiday in a family have to do with creativity versus that hustle for perfection.
Right.
So
yeah, that's a great idea.
Well, there's a little more to share in that way.
Never thought of it that way, but that's totally true.
Yeah. There's, you know, I think it's nice because Halloween's one of those holidays where it's like you can try to market it as much as you can, but it's still really wholly about creativity that anyone can participate in it. It's very like not exclusive, which is cool. And I mean, I'm speaking from like an obviously like American perspective, because I know around the world it's not as big of a thing, but. Or there's different things, but at least from my Midwestern perspective, it always felt very inclusive.
We used to go up to Salem, Massachusetts, of course, has just epic Halloween festivities. And it's a lot of fun. And, you know, like the witches, the actual practicing witches come out, and it's just such an awesome freak show.
It's so delightful. I was actually there the weekend the weekend before Halloween last year in Salem.
Oh, no kidding.
It just timed out perfectly that I was doing an event, and everybody from the event in Boston just went over, so we got to see everybody from the con, you know, relaxing and doing. But there, I swear, there were some artists on the street, one right in front of I forget the name, the family's home, but the witch house, the one that's right at the end of the road. There was a woman selling her like hand illustrated greeting cards. She didn't have an online presence or, you know, much of a business card at all. And I swear, like some of the people you meet on the street, like in Salem, like they really do feel the most authentic and magical, like when you really can't track them after.
Well, you know, after. What's cool is they're rocking that stuff all year, and you know, even up in Salem, that, you know, people are like, oh, okay, Carol, you know, but you know, Halloween week, they're the go-to people, they're the ones, you know, they're on the news, and so they're shining. It's cool.
Yeah, I love the people that you can still find, especially older craftspeople who, like, you just can't find them other than at events. And, you know, there's that feeling of setting up your wares and then, like, disappearing into the mist, and you never know if you find them. And there's something, like, that's so different about the world that, you know, that we're in, where we, you know, have to market ourselves and stuff. And I'm like, there's a childlike wonder about that. Like, where did they go from? Where did they come from? Where did they go?
That's a perfect way to put it. That, you know, that is nice. They do have that childlike wonder. And it's funny. I always come away from those kinds of things, and other, you know, other events that are similarly, you know, celebratory of you know, unusual things. And I always think, man, I wish I was that free.
But
it might be a nice place to visit, you know, not necessarily where you'd want to live, so to speak, you know, that frame of mind.
Sure.
You know?
It certainly was a great break for like after a convention, just to
get away. What convention was it?
I'm gonna sound like a nerd, but it actually was a Harry Potter themed convention in Boston at the Seaport Hotel.
Oh, cool.
And it was like that, and it was a bunch of fantasy stuff. I didn't know how big it would be, but it actually was a pretty good turnout, but it was more of a fan convention. There were a lot of cool artists there.
There were a lot of what?
There are a lot of good artists there in the artist alley.
Oh,
so.
That's another thing, you know, I saw a thing in the New York Times about what are these different con, you know, artist row artists doing with this whole thing. A lot of them are kind of taking it online, but that's not making up for this avenue they were able to build and make a living from.
Yeah, I don't think anyone has the answers for that right now, but
no.
We'll just have to wait and see.
Dale, how are you doing with time?
Oh, this isn't going to get better if that's what you're asking. More time is just going to prolong the suffering, I think.
Well, it's good. Let's keep going.
All right. If this is your idea of good programming, then that's fine with me.
This is great, great TV. Oh,
good.
Great programming.
No one's ever accused of us of that before. So.
Yeah.
Oh, I disagree. There have been some really great nights and great moments in this. And, you know, tonight had some great moments. This particular one you're looking at isn't really one of the greatest moments, but it's a moment, you know?
I just like that I have a group to draw with.
What's that?
I just like that I have a group to draw with. I was thinking about that just at basic level, and I was like, you know, it's good to just have you guys.
I agree. I've been looking for, you know, a group to draw with for years. It's just never felt right, or, you know, been organic.
Right.
And, and it's nice because most of us are in a different area of what we do, but, you know, we deal with very similar issues, right?
Right, like where we all want to draw or paint something like with reference.
Yeah, and we've got to deal with clients in some degree with what we're doing here. And we know how to look. Every one of us, if we had to do something presentable in an hour, you know, we could get it done.
Right.
So
maybe 2 hours.
Yeah.
Well, what I would do is I would just take a screenshot of what one of you are doing and present that and not tell them it wasn't mine until you cut the check.
I was part of this experience. I watched. That was my part, but I was part of this experience.
No,
Dale would just hang out till they paid him.
Yeah,
that's right. I'm here. Yeah, I'm not going anywhere.
This just brings me back to my high school experience of trying to join bands and being the least talented person in the room.
Let's talk about Timmy.
Yeah. Yeah.
How did that make you feel, Timmy?
Oh, yeah. Well, I should be getting something out of this, Bill. So if it's a little bit of therapy.
You want to talk about that?
Yeah, let's talk about it. No, yeah. It's nice. It's nice to be here and, you know, watch the town.
The only other drawing group I've been a part of is when I taught a class, you know.
Yeah.
Or taken a class years ago, but.
I think it's important that, like, well, another thing is that I think the thing that made this really makes this fun for me is that it is like a super casual, pretty honest conversations. Oh, you know, we're not putting on a show.
There's not a theme or anything besides the subject.
There, we don't have a drum roll ever, you know. I do want to get a laugh track though, because occasionally I feel like I have said things that deserve some laughter, and everybody's muted, and I'm like, okay.
Oh, so you want okay?
Yeah. I think that Ray has said things that have cracked me up, and then I noticed I was muted, and I was like, oh man, he deserved a laugh there.
Yeah.
But my favorite thing that Gil has said to me, he sent me a message back after the first or second time he joined us, and he goes, I really like this. That's a great hang. I just thought that's a, and he says it to me every time.
He's hanging out. He was hanging when he was here. He was hanging out with like 300 people.
Yeah, it's a great hang, man. Of course I'll be.
It's great. Like,
Bill can pull that off. I can't.
Yeah. Well, Timmy, I think you're just hilarious. don't worry.
That's what I was fishing for. If you couldn't tell, I was trying to be subtle, but.
We need some validation. No, I told myself that like I need to just like come to this drawing group even if I'm feeling that crap and if I'm like needing to be quiet. I'm like, it's just better to be there than to not. So, you know, the silence is, I feel like, you know, when you're talking and people don't laugh, it, you know, it's not always like personal. So
sometimes. Hold on, I have it for you. Hold on. Where are we?
That sounds like an audience of people being hurt.
That sounds like elephants.
Oh, they love you, Timmy. They love you.
Oh, I like that one. That one was nice. The first one was like an audience shriek. like, what did Timmy do?
The audacity.
I want it when the we were watching the ball game earlier. I want them to get the boo tracks going too.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Well, can you hear the players cursing now? Or has that been
fixed?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah.
What I like is you can hear what they say to the umpire sometimes. You know, like when they're at the plate and they think it's a strike and it's called a ball or vice versa, whatever.
Is that white pastel you're putting on there?
Yeah.
Cool. It looks very delicate because I noticed when you were erasing out, it came up very quickly.
Yeah, it's it moves easy, that's for sure. I like using these things because it feels like painting.
Yeah.
And I always have a thing about, I like using my hands, but I assume the oil from your hands is gonna mess with the drawing or maybe how it reacts. And I just generally, I want as few, I make enough problems. I don't want to invite more, you know what I mean?
Yeah, okay.
Want to know the truth of it, Dale?
Oh.
I much more prefer when you draw than paint. because then the odds of you saying drawing multiple times a night, because that's my favorite thing you say. It's not drawing. It's drawing.
And, oh, do I say that?
Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, that's really interesting. Oh, I love that you said that. So what do I say?
Say drawing.
Drawing. Oh, I put an R on it.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I'm so glad you pointed that out.
Oh, I love.
See, I have excised a certain amount of the Boston accent, but that little sneaky bugger is sticking in there along with a few other things. It's interesting.
I'm trying to think of, the crazy movie series the comedian did, but you know, the
Crashing.
No, it's you were watching him when you were a kid. I can't believe Austin Powers.
Oh yeah,
and he did that Saturday Night Live skit. The drawings. I'm gonna get
drawings.
The drawing. In the bathtub.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's funny. So I put an R on it.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay.
You put a really long W on it too.
Draw.
Draw.
What do you say? Well, how do you say it?
Drawing.
Drawings.
Draw. So wait, there's no R. Drawing. Draw.
Drawing.
Drawings.
Drawing. I would just love it for somebody to tune in just right now. and they'd be like, everybody told me that this visual arts passage thing was so educational.
Drawing. Oh, wow.
So, okay. You knew exactly what I meant when I said it, didn't you?
Who, me?
Bill Cope. He knew what I was talking about when I said it.
Oh, that's the back room where you make fun of me.
Simon, and I like to do drawings.
That's funny.
Okay, so hold on. Official podcast, that should be the intro.
What, me saying drawings?
No, all of us.
drawings.
Oh, that's
great.
That's a good idea.
Just a super cut of drawing.
Yeah,
drawing.
Welcome to
drawing. I'm going to do a drawing.
Nice one. But Cousteau says they're jealous of your drawing.
It's very endearing.
Yeah.
Well,
somebody tuning in.
It's like, oh, if you can't say it, you can't do it.
Bill, you don't need to code switch for us.
Yeah.
I'm going to practice this now.
I never really noticed.
I did not know.
When
Dale,
I go
Dale, it's any consolation. I did not notice either.
Well, I always appreciate being called out for whatever shortcoming I have.
Especially publicly.
It's not a shortcoming at all.
No, I don't take it as one. I seriously though, I do enjoy being enlightened about whatever idiosyncratic thing I'm doing. Because we don't really always see ourselves, right?
Oh, not at all.
Never.
I posted a link to Simon so you can see it.
To what?
To the thing we were talking about.
Oh.
I posted a YouTube link to the chat. As I finished drawing
So let me back up. So John, you're saying you prefer when I draw
when you're
painting, because I can say painting
just fine.
Oh,
and you can say drawing fine too, but it's very evident where you come from.
Well, we haven't talked about sculpture.
Sculpture.
Oh, I love freaking sculpture.
Wow, I like it.
Oof. That looks great.
Jenna shared the video. It's Mike Myers and Danny DeVito.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to think of Mike Myers' name. I couldn't think of his
name. Yeah, Mike Myers. I put it in the chat.
I have not seen that.
It's great.
I saw the funniest thing the other day. It was these three English guys, I believe they were English, and they were doing a bring your dad to school. You know, what does your dad do for work? And they're all adults, but one of the guys like, you know, my dad's a firefighter. And the next kid's like, what does your dad do for a living? My dad's a social influencer.
Wow.
So the dad comes in, you know, and the guy does this American accent, and he's got his camera, you know, his phone on his selfie stick. It is hilarious.
Anthony says, your drawings are wicked good, Dale.
Oh, wow. Wicked good? Yeah.
Wicked good drawings.
Wicked good. Wicked good, kid.
Yeah.
When I was little, my parents' favorite thing I said was I would say I'm drawing a Pikachu. I couldn't say picture.
Oh.
I would add a little extra Pikachu. Yeah, like I'm just drawing. Like I want to go away now and draw a Pikachu. And she's like, oh, like, okay.
I like that too.
Hey, mom, can you take a Pikachu? Like just a little extra. I don't think it was any Michigan accent. It was just me thinking that there was a little extra bit to the picture.
Gianna told me like earlier this year that I've been not even for a minute my argument was that it was regional, but that I was just mispronouncing the word crayon.
Like what word?
Crayon. Like crayon. Like, I was just saying crayon.
What, Timmy? What word?
I have PTSD about it. I was saying crown my whole life.
No, you weren't.
I was. I argued with her for too long. Crown.
No.
Oh, Erica says she says crown too. But yeah, now okay. I'm saying crown.
I've never even heard it that way. Crown.
I've never even heard that.
Laura says in Baltimore they say crown. So maybe I grew up in Baltimore.
Yeah.
Jeez. Your Pikachu looks great.
Yeah.
Your drawing. I can't even say it. It's horrible.
Drawing.
I couldn't pronounce R's when I was a kid. So it was like drawing.
That's so cute.
Look at the car. The car.
Yeah, I had the car.
I feel like I think a lot of little kids.
Yeah,
that's like a common one that you hear.
Okay, well, we're a few minutes over here, so
thank God.
We're done.
Time of death.
So your speech therapy session, Dale, is.
Yeah, this
episode. We'll wrap it up. We'll wrap it up today. We'll meet next week.
We had a wing.
Yeah.
Drawing.
I'm gonna practice drawing.
Drawing.
Shouldn't we check out everybody's work?
This isn't even a drink and draw.
Yeah. Well, Audrey, we can't afford to have a drink and draw.
Yeah, this is our sober draw.
This is oh wow.
Wow. Audrey, that's awesome.
I can't see it. Hold on.
I'm just flipping through everybody's stuff. Oh, I like your screen there, the Marie Sendek guy.
Audrey, this is awesome. So great.
Wow. Did you continue working on that through the?
I did that one for the.
That is killer.
Well, that's nice, Audrey.
Some of the purple that I was
very cool.
John, wow.
John, that's awesome.
John, nice drawing.
I drew John Foster.
That's really funny. Oh God, we don't want to see that guy. Oh, nice.
Oh, Dale, you got. I love yours, Dale. It's great. Thanks, Dale. Bill, awesome.
Thank you.
Love it.
What a fun night.
That's nice.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Should we? I know it's getting late. Should we? Hey, check out some work.
Jimmy, yeah. Can I ask a big favor?
Yeah.
I got to get up like crazy early in the morning, and I got to run out and do something right now. Can I?
Can what
I?
Gotta do.
Yeah.
Let's free. Let's free John.
Hey, everybody! Thank you so much. Timmy can wrap this up, and Dale can work on the practicing. But I, as always, I love growing with you guys. You did, guys, gals, everybody. It just great.
Thanks, John. It was great.
It always makes me get a big smile. Thank you, everybody.
All right. See you, John.
Thanks for the stories, too.
Okay.
Hey, so, you are the host now, Timmy, right? So if I leave.
Oh, man. I am. What? I am the host.
Doug Bell. Okay. That is amazing.
Awesome. Yeah.
Doug, you're drawing. You have to draw with us next. You have to like be spotlight next
week. Hey,
oh my God!
And you know what? I've been meaning to say this. I forgot to say this the other week. When we go through everybody's drawings, don't take it personally if we don't say anything. We might not say something about everybody's artwork. If this is your first time attending, and we like fly by, just because there's so much awesome artwork. Everybody does great. Don't ever take it personally. And I promise you, if you attend this a couple times, eventually you're going to get the panelists to talk about your art. So I just don't want anybody to think that we're, that silence is bad or anything. It's just, honestly, I could go, every time we pass something because it's so cool. So
good point.
Wow.
Jerry, thanks.
Wow, really nice. That's excellent.
Hey, Audrey, there was a question. I don't know if it got answered, but Michael Deere asked what kind of paint you were using.
Oh, it's acrylic Winsor & Newton Gallery. That's always my go-to acrylic.
Uh-oh. Anthony, that's awesome.
That's gorgeous, Anthony.
Jonathan, awesome.
Nice.
Thanks for always joining.
Oh, that's a nice one.
Oh, that's good.
Oh, wow.
Cool. Copped in.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's fantastic.
Yeah. I love that.
Awesome.
Whoa.
Whoa, whoa.
Dang.
Whoa.
Sweet. Very cool.
Very nice.
Marcy, that's awesome. Cool. Marcy, is your first time drawing with us?
Oh, that's good.
Oh, Victor, nice one.
Whoa.
Oh, beautiful.
These are amazing.
Andrew, really nice.
Will, awesome to be here. Struggle mode.
Oh, man.
Who did that one?
Erica Paints. Is that Erica Bodger? Erica, I apologize if I mispronounced your last name. Or if really that's nice. Not you.
That's really nice. I see all these, and it makes me want to try some of these different techniques that people are doing.
Me too.
I think I'm going to try painting next week.
You know what? I will too.
You can do it.
Another beautiful one, Erica. Oh, wow.
Whoa, Julian. Sweet.
Great.
Oh, that's a nice one.
Yeah, that's great.
Sweet.
Wow. Ooh, nice. Oh. That almost has like a Shroud of Turin kind of vibe.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
Oh, Anna. Oh, nice, Anna.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Mary's keeping track of time. 25.
Oh, nice, Chuck.
Oh, beautiful, Chuck. Ooh, that's cool.
Nice line.
Wow.
That's very cool.
Yeah. The cardboard.
So cool, I love cardboard. Lowers the stakes, right? Isn't that what you said before, Bill?
What's that?
Lowers the stakes a little bit.
Yeah. It's just like some of my best stuff, I think, is on cardboard.
Yeah.
Gary. Yeah. Very nice. Sticky notes for me.
Sticky notes, yeah. Oh, whoa, Roberto.
Yeah.
Cool.
That's beautiful.
Wow.
Nice.
So Audrey, do you gesso your sticky notes first? Or?
Yeah. Gesso my sticky notes?
Oh, man. I'm going to have to get like a...
Brian, like... Yeah,
I'm gonna put my address down. Anybody wants to send me any of these? I love this. Yeah. This is cool.
Wow, that's beautiful.
Yeah, that picture I just loved working from.
Isn't it such a great photo? The color in it's so awesome.
It already has like the a palette for you.
That's cool. Yeah. And that one.
Audrey, that's a really great way of saying it. I've never thought about why I liked that photo so much. And it really is that it's like already done.
It's sort of maybe like the complimentary palette.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why it was like, it went the easiest. I mean, that's why the Waves brothers were a bit more challenging for me, I think in a good way, but it was just because you had to filter because the palette was really limitless.
Yeah.
Right. I hadn't thought about that, yeah.
Wow. That's good.
That's beautiful.
Whoa.
Oh, that's cool.
That's really cool, Kathy.
No.
Whoa.
Very cool.
Wow.
Really captures our shoulder hair.
Oh, you know, Timmy, you're gonna have to be shirtless now.
No. No way, man.
We need visual evidence.
Visual evidence passage.
Oh man, he is so good.
That's awesome, Doug.
Yeah, wow. Doug, you're fantastic.
That's like a whole new thing for you. That's really cool.
That is a perfect way to approach that particular reference, just because of like how, I don't know, like how the purples and the rich like darkness in his gradations were. That's such a fun way to approach that.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Doug might be getting upgraded to the panel.
Oh, that's cool.
Wow.
Nice.
Awesome, Marcy. Pierre. Awesome. Ah, cool, Hugo.
Oh, cool.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
Number two. Boy, that's beautiful.
That's really nice.
Mr. Payne.
Hey, this guy's pretty good.
Wow.
I think we should upgrade
him.
Yeah, he's okay.
Keep him off the panel.
Yeah. Keep him off the panel. Keep him off the panel. Wow. Wow. Those are fighting words.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, man.
That's nice.
Whoa. A lot of people drawing with us tonight. This is great. Doug.
Oh, really beautiful.
Oh boy, man.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Grim Ross.
Oh yeah, Felicity, bringing it.
Oh, that's nice.
Which reference was that?
The little dragon.
Yeah.
Got the turtle, and that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I like the whole shape around it too.
Wow.
That's awesome, Chris.
Wow.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Definitely keep him off the panel.
Yeah. Hey, Timmy, my link doesn't work anymore. I don't know what to tell you, Chris.
Oh, next one, Cassandra.
Wow. Okay. Cool. Do you guys want to look at Instagram real quick?
Sure.
Sure.
Yeah. If you got to duck out, that's totally okay. But I kind of want to check it out. This is...
Bill, that's really nice.
Thanks. It's funny. It's a lot darker on the, on, at least on my computer screen than...
Wow. That's great.
What did you use? Just a, like a soft...
It's a new pastel, and then I used mostly a blue, and then I erased
okay.
a bunch and went in a little bit with a like a white color. Oh, that's gorgeous.
It is.
Yeah, holy smokes.
Yeah, beautiful.
Oh, cool. Oh,
very nice.
Isaac, awesome.
Beautiful. Oh, wow.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
Very confident.
Oh, that's cool.
Cool.
Oh, that's nice too, huh? Dublin.
That's a mat. Nice.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Laura, very cool. Love these.
Yeah.
Really good.
So cool.
Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah.
So great. One. Sweet.
That's beautiful.
Love it, Hugo. I saw it. Cool.
Nice one.
No, that's cool.
Sweet. I love that one.
Man, oh, he's nice. Good. Make sure Chuck stays off this too. Victor too. You're all off.
Yeah.
You're off the pet island. You're
really,
off the island.
Really?
These are so cool.
Yeah, it's that nice that there's so many really accomplished drawers.
Yeah, man.
Oh, that's really beautiful.
Wow.
Yeah, I like that.
Julian, awesome.
Boy, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
Always count on Julian to be here. This is great.
Nice one.
Ooh,
oh, that's fun.
Nice.
That is fun.
That's cool. It's a Shroud of Turin.
Yeah, again, really nice work.
That's beautiful, Chuck.
It's funny, you know, my dad got so into Instagram and his account and everything. The only thing he'd be upset about tonight is he'd be like, you didn't have anybody tag me.
Funny.
He'd be cracking up. I was thinking about that. He'd be like, I'm not getting any of these likes.
That's funny.
None of these people are following me.
he was into Instagram?
Oh, man. He loved it. And you know what's crazy, Dale, is he reconnected with like several people from the Cousteau Society that he had not seen since the 80s.
Oh, that's great.
They like stumbled across each other. Like,
like kind of like early in like 2012. He was like an early adopter of Instagram.
Wow.
Yeah, that's like right when I started to be a thing.
Oh yeah, we both started Instagram around the same time. Yeah.
That's really nice.
Yeah. These are great.
Oh, that's cool. Good ones.
You go awesome.
Yeah. Oh, I like
sweet.
That.
Ooh, wow. Almost Ralph Steadman-y there, huh?
Yeah. That's cool too.
Wow.
Nice. That's okay. Cool. Who's that guy?
He's nobody. He's
going places. That guy's going places.
Looks a lot like Chris Painsworth.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude's ripping him off.
That's beautiful, too.
I should report it.
I think so. So I saw some company in Asia was using the illustration isolation.
Oh, yeah.
To promote, like, art craft products or something like that.
Oh.
Yeah. So
sent them a nice email. Please stop using this.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
cool. Oh, Robert. I'm so glad Robert was here. He's a man.
Oh, Dale, Robert commented at one point, and I forgot to mention it. He goes, Dale can shred.
Oh, I was going to say, I hope he was heckling me.
Oh.
Robert's such a good guy.
So glad he's not on the panel.
Oh, man, we got to get him on. He's best. He is the best.
I love those. I love all the demos that he posts.
Sweet.
Yeah. He's just such an unassuming ninja.
Yeah.
As a ninja.
That's cool.
So cool.
Nice.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Sweet.
Yeah, that's really beautiful.
Montalvo.
Yeah. All right.
Hey, thanks so much for joining, guys. As always, Audrey, awesome to have you here. The whole team, Dale, Bill. I know George was here earlier. Chris, John, everybody. Thank you so much for joining. It means a lot, and it's always fun hanging out with you guys. So
it is. Conversation is always good.
It's been really special. So
thanks for sharing Dad's photos and the stories.
Oh, it's really sweet. It's very touching. I say this to everybody, the audience included. It is very special to see all these drawings today. It means a lot to me.
Well, so thank you. You know, it's great. I loved it when your dad was doing started Instagram. I was
Man. Well, thanks so much, everybody. Have a nice night.
You too.
We're going to continue. We're going to continue down the Amazon and maybe into a couple more of the expeditions coming up soon. I'm hoping, I'm hoping, fingers crossed, we can get a surprise guest speaker, maybe somebody that was around for this stuff. So we'll continue that. To be continued.
All right, Timmy.
No promises, right. Audrey. But I got a couple calls out, so.
Cool.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah.
All right.
All right. Have a good night, guys.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Take care, everyone. Good night.